And everybody said,
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Wonderful to be with you again. But I want to know the people, you can sit down, God bless you. I want to know those who are from Lagos Island, where are you? Can you please stand up? I welcome you as you welcome me in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you very much. From Suleri, where are you? Wonderful. God bless every one of you. And I will welcome you to our leaders' meeting today. From Festac, where are you? Almost the whole house. God bless every one of you. And our leaders from Yaba, where are we? Wonderful. God bless every one of you. I pray that today the leaders' meeting will enrich everybody's life in Jesus' name. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for bringing your people. Thank you for all that you are doing. Every Tuesday, as your leaders gather together, I'm asking, Lord, that tonight you impart your power into the life of every leader in Jesus' name. Make us, Lord, suitable for this work. And give us real spiritual life. And let the supernatural of your spirit come into every life and make us capable, effective, competent leaders in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
God bless you. Consider, we're coming to Romans chapter 12. As we look at Romans chapter 12, we're looking at verses 1 and 2. Romans chapter 12, I read to you from verses 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And then it goes on to say, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. As we read those verses, you are wondering, why is Paul the apostle by the Spirit writing this to us? You understand? Every part of the word of God is written to the believer. And every part of the word of God is written to those who are workers in the vineyard of the Lord. And every part of the word of God is written to ministers, is written to leaders. As we approach this passage as leaders, leaders among the people of God, and preachers and pastors in the vineyard of the Lord, what do we learn from this? What's the reason? What's the purpose? Why is Paul the apostle writing this to us? He's telling us, look at verse 6. It says, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry. It comes to the ministry, and it says, are we ministers? Are we leaders? Are we preachers? Are we pastors? We have the ministry. And then it says, so ministry, let us wait on our ministry. And then it says, so he that teacheth on teaching. It's telling us that we have received the ministry. And as we have received the ministry, we concentrate on the ministry. We focus on the ministry. We wait on the ministry. And we apply our heart, our soul, everything we've got, we apply that to the minister. And then it says now, I beseech you therefore. I want you to put yourself there. That Paul the apostle is saying, he has called you. He has appointed you. He has ordained you and appointed you to do something peculiar and something definite in the kingdom of God. And before you can succeed, you must have this in mind, that you lay yourself on his altar once again. And he says, I beseech you by the mercies of God, for the believer, the mercy that saves. The mercy that chose us and the mercy that selected us out of the multitudes of people, and then he called us by his mercy and love and grace, we are saved. But then you are thinking about yourself now as a leader and as a minister. Paul the apostle never lost the wonder of the choice of God upon his life. He said, I am not worthy even to be called the least of the saints of God, and yet he has appointed me. And he said, I received mercy. Think about the mercy that came to you, that God has appointed you as a worker, as a leader, as a pastor, as a shepherd over the people of God by the mercies of God that you have received. Though unqualified, yet he puts you there. And though you have not been your very best every minute, every moment, every day of ministry, and yet he puts you there. He says, by the mercies of God, then let's respond to that mercy. Let us reciprocate that love and that mercy, that though unqualified, yet he has chosen me. And then now that you present your body a living sacrifice, it's referring to the Old Testament and bringing the old to the new. The dead sacrifices of the Old Testament, they bring the animal and then the animal is killed and is sacrificed. It says all that was written for our learning upon whom the ends of the world are come. And it says, now you bring your sacrifice, is not to be killed, is to live. You bring your sacrifice, is not to die, is to minister. You bring your sacrifice, is to do something and perform the work of the ministry. Make it a living sacrifice, and then make sure that you are bringing your body to him as a living sacrifice. There are people that do not understand that our bodies play a great part in our commitment in the work of the Lord. Your brain, your mind, your eyes, your ears, your voice, the way you train your voice and the way you speak as a minister, you bring that voice to the Lord as a living sacrifice, not a dull sacrifice, and it is not a dying sacrifice. Sometimes, you know, when we're talking, when we're preaching, in communication, even your eyes, you look, the way you look at the people when you are talking to them, and the way you gesticulate, and the way you demonstrate, and the use of your hand, and the use of your body, because there's body language when we're preaching. As you look at the people, and as you point to the people, and as you bend, as you do whatever you're doing, it says you're presenting your body as a living sacrifice unto God, and then it is holy, and it is purified by the blood of the Lamb. And it says, now this will be your acceptable and reasonable service. Then it says, and be not conformed to this world, but by renewing your mind by the word of God. Renewing your mind by the blood, the cleansing blood of the Lamb. It says, now you are able to minister to the Lord, and you find out what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. But why all that? Why are we ministers? Why are we reading this? You come to Numbers. I'm reading from chapter 6. Numbers chapter 6. And we're looking at it from verse 1. Here we find a group of people. And I just want to remind you that these things are written for our learning, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Now whatsoever was written in the Old Testament, it was written so that we look at that and we say, oh, that's something. I never thought of that before. How does that help me in the ministry? How does that help me as a minister, as a preacher, and as a worker in the vineyard of the Lord? We're looking at Numbers chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when a man, either man or woman, shall separate themselves to vow a vow of a Nazarite. Then it says to separate themselves unto the Lord. I want you to mark the word separate. There, underline the word separate. Anywhere you find the word separate in this passage I'm reading, it says when either a man or a woman shall separate, that's the word, themselves to a vow of a Nazarite to, what's the next word there? Separate themselves unto the Lord. Mark that again. And then it says, he shall, what's the next word? Separate himself from wine and strong drink, and shall drink no vinegar of wine, or vinegar of strong drink. Neither shall he drink any liquor of grapes, nor eat moist grapes or dried. And then it goes on to verse 4. It says, all the days of his, the next word there, separation, mark that too, he shall eat nothing that is made of the vine tree, from the kernels even to the husk. All the days of the vow of his, tell me, separation, mark that too, there shall no razor come upon his head until the days be fulfilled in the which he separateth himself unto the Lord. And then he goes on to say, and he shall be, what's the word? Holy, mark that too. And he shall let the locks of the hair of his head grow all the days that he, tell me, separateth himself unto the Lord. He shall come at no dead body. He shall not make himself unclean for his father or for his mother, for his brother or for his sister, when they die, because the, tell me, the consecration of his God is upon him. All the days of his separation, he is holy unto the Lord. What do you notice, comes up often and often? Separate, separated, separation. How many times? Tell me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How many times? Again? Okay. Comes up a lot of times. And you will see over here that we're talking of a person separating himself, or a man or a woman separating herself. I want you to notice the Nazarite, because many people don't understand who these Nazarites were. And then what is the vow of the Nazarite? And what is the Lord telling us to learn from the Nazarite? I want you to understand that, number one, it is when either man or woman, it is an individual thing. This is not something that somebody compels you and imposes upon you. Number one, it is individual and it is not general. This is not a congregational kind of decision, a congregational kind of motivation, a congregational kind of consecration. Number one, it is a personal, individual, not general. And then it says, shall separate themselves. It is voluntary. It is voluntary. It is something that you say, this is the way I'm going, and this is what I'm going to do. And it is not something that somebody compels you, forces you into. Number two, it is something voluntary, not compulsory. It says, shall vow a vow. Shall vow a vow. It's talking of something that is personal. This is an individual thing. And this is something, it's not something that somebody will come and talk you out of it later, because you thought about it and then you prayed about it and you saw that this is the way to glorify the Lord, and you, with your own volition and your own will and your own determination, the Jesus said, this is what I'm going to do. And so trial may come, I took my decision. Situations may arise, I took my decision. And the winds may blow, I took my decision. It's something that the Lord wants you to think through, and he's saying that this is a personal commitment that you have made. And then he goes on to say, all the days of his separation, of his vow, which means it was a specific period, and the period for him was determined by himself. It was the one that says, for this period I give myself, for this moment I give myself. It was a specified, specific, or limited period. And then he goes on to say in verse 5, until the days are over, until all those days are finished. That means a prescribed period. It says this period, that's what I'm going to do. And then he goes on to say, he separates himself unto the Lord. Unto the Lord, this is something that he gives to the Lord, and it's very mindful. He has his own reason. He has the reason where with that, Lord, the reason why. He said, this is going to be given to the Lord at this time. And then you have a separation coming a number of times. And then you have the word in verse 7, consecration. When I lost from here, that as you come to serve the Lord, it's not like you're not doing a service, you're not doing it for somebody, you're not doing it for the senior pastor, you're not doing it for a great overseer, you're not doing it to please anyone. This is something you've made a choice of. Rainy season or dry season, that's my choice. Whether it is far or it is near, that's my choice. Whether the church is large or the church is small, that's my choice. I've given this to the Lord, and I pray that as you have opened your mouth to the Lord, you'll never go back, in Jesus' name. Now, I want to notice the difference between the Nazarite and the Levite. We know the Levites, we've heard of the Levites. And what were the Levites to do? And why were the Levites appointed? Number one, those Levites were called to separation. Called to separation. This is not something that, you know, is just like, you know, I want to or I don't want to, I decide or I don't decide, I will or I will not. He was a Levite and he was called unto separation. Number two, he was a Levite because of that he was commissioned for service. Commissioned for service. Again, this is not like a Nazarite. A Nazarite will say, I want to vow this and give myself for 1 month. That's his decision. I want to do this and give my service only for 1 year. That's his decision. Until the end of the period, he gave himself to the Lord. But not this, this is a Levite right now. And the Levite, number one, is called to what? To separation. Number two is commissioned for service. Number three is consecrated by sacrifice. Consecrated by sacrifice. That's a Levite. And as you look at the Levite in the Old Testament, you'll find out that he was committed and consecrated by sacrifice, and then he was confirmed as sanctified. Confirmed as sanctified. You know, go through a lot of passages in the Bible, and you will see how the Lord talks about the Levites, called and commissioned and consecrated and confirmed. Now that is very near and close to leadership today. It's very near and close to those of us who say we're leaders in the church, that will say we're pastors in church. Number one, we are called to separation. We're called to separation. Did you hear what God said? He said, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, says the Lord God Almighty. This is not something like, okay, it's my choice or I don't want to. This one, you are called to separation. Because every believer and every worker and every minister, it says, depart ye that bear the vessel of the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. This one is a definite call from the Lord. It's not a voluntary thing, whether I like it or I don't like it. This is my choice, this is my choice. You're not a Nazarite. You are a leader, and your calling is like that of the Levite. And it says, depart ye, ye that bear the vessel of the Lord. Number one, then, you are called to separation. Number two, you are commissioned to service. You are commissioned to service. You're not just, you know, we find some people that say, I am a pastor. And we say, where is your congregation? He says, well, I don't have any congregation. Hey, you're not a pastor. Other people said, I'm a worker. I said, what worker are you doing? He says, well, really, I don't have any portfolio. I don't have any work I'm doing, but I'm a worker. If you're a worker in the New Testament, if you're a worker in the Word of God, it says you are commissioned to serve. You are commissioned for service. Did you hear what he said? He said that you may not conform to this world, but that you are renewed in your mind, and then you offer service unto the Lord. A reasonable service you give unto the Lord. You have a ministry, wait on that ministry. You are teaching, wait on that teaching. Or it is you are counseling, wait on that, because you are commissioned for service. And then you are consecrated in sacrifice. Consecrated in sacrifice. You know what the Word of God says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 14? If we know that he died for us, then we're all dead. And then it says, I'm crucified with Christ in Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. Nevertheless, I live. And the life I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. We are consecrated by sacrifice. And we're to sacrifice everything we've got. The things that were gained to me, I count them as loss for the Lord Jesus Christ, that I may win Christ and know the power of his resurrection. And then we're confirmed through sanctification. Confirmed through sanctification. If a man therefore purge himself from this, it shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and made for the master's use. And so as you think about our ministry and the calling he has given us, and then you look at those Levites, our service, our calling, our commission, our confirmation, our consecration, very similar to that of the Levites. Tonight we're looking at the message, the redemptive ministry of Levites and leaders. The redemptive ministry of leaders and Levites. Levites and leaders. Redemptive ministry. As you think about the Levites, and then we have seen their calling, we've seen their commission, we've seen their consecration, and we've seen their confirmation. As you think about these Levites, what's the purpose of their ministry? Have you ever thought about it? Here we'll find Levites, we'll find Levites, we'll find Levites from the time of Exodus, Levites. And then in Numbers, Levites. You come to the Kings and to the Chronicles, you have Levites. What was the purpose of their ministry? Number one, the preventive ministry of the Levites. Preventive ministry of the Levites. The Levites were to prevent something from happening. They were to look at the congregation of the people of God, and they were to say, we're going to prevent this, that happening to the congregation. We'll look at that. Number two, the purposeful ministry of true leaders. If we're leaders today in the church of the living God, what's our ministry? And what's the purposeful ministry for which you are called, for which we are all called? The purposeful ministry of true leaders. Number three, the perpetual misery of the lost. The perpetual misery of the lost. If we don't get to them, if we don't reach out to them, if we don't touch their lives, if we don't carry our commission to them, to those lost people, the perpetual misery that they're going to have, the perpetual misery of the lost. Number one. What's number one over there? The preventive ministry of the Levites. Always have this in your mind. If you are in a ministry, you must ask yourself, why am I here? Why am I doing this? Why am I not in another trade? Why am I not in the market? Why am I not in the shop? Why am I not in a school? Why am I not in a company? Why am I not in that other place? Why am I here? We're looking at Numbers chapter 1. Numbers chapter 1. I'm looking at verse 53. Numbers chapter 1, we're reading from verse 53, talking about the Levites and talking about the reason for their call. the reason for their commission, the reason for their consecration, the reason for their confirmation. In Numbers chapter 1, reading from verse 53, but, are you there? I said, have you opened the page? It says, but the Levites shall pitch round about the tabernacle of testimony, that there be no wrath upon the congregation of the children of Israel. That's the purpose. That's the goal. It says the Levites will put themselves in strategic places, and they will pitch around the congregation of the children of Israel, so that in order that there will be no wrath upon the congregation of the children of Israel, and the Levites shall keep the charge of the tabernacle of testimony. The wrath of God is upon the world. The wrath of God is upon sinners, and the wrath of God comes upon the people that are righteous, ungodly, and unholy. And it was the ministry of the Levites to shield and protect the congregation of the children of Israel in their millions, so that the wrath of God will not come upon them. As you think about the ministry from the New Testament onwards, and you think about John the Baptist, and you see the opening pages of the New Testament, you see what he was saying. He was saying, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? What was his ministry? To prevent the people from experiencing the wrath of the Lord. Have you needed to Jesus Christ? He that believeth on me shall not be condemned, but he that believeth not on me is condemned already, and the wrath of God abides on him. Have you listened to Colossians chapter 3? In Colossians chapter 3, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. And then he begins to mention them, and he said, for which cause the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. What's our ministry then? As we look at the Levites, we're to prevent the wrath of God coming upon people. That's why we preach salvation. That's why we talk about holiness. That's why we talk about the will of God. That's why we talk about knowing the scriptures and following the scriptures, so that like the Levites, we prevent the wrath of God coming upon the people. And let's go to Second Chronicles. In Second Chronicles, I'm reading from chapter 19. Second Chronicles chapter 19. And these Levites, we meet them again, and we see the way they prepared themselves. And the Lord is telling us the way you also prepare yourself, because now you know the purpose of the ministry of the Levites, and you know the purpose of the ministry of the leaders today as well. Second Chronicles chapter, tell me, chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 7. It says, wherefore now let the fear of the Lord be upon you, and take heed and do it for them. For then is for there is no iniquity with the Lord our God. And then it says, no respect of persons, nor taking of bribes. Moreover, it's telling this. Now seeing in Jerusalem, it says that the Jehoshaphat said of the Levites and of the priests, and then he goes on to say, and the chief of the fathers of Israel, for the judgment, counsel for the Lord. And then it says, for controversies, counseling the people, helping the people, when they returned to Jerusalem. And he charged them, remember the them here, the Levites, remember the them here, the priests, these people that were choosing so that they'll present the word of God and they'll prevent the wrath of God coming upon them. It says he charged them, saying, thus shall ye do in the fear of the Lord faithfully and with a perfect heart. Look at verse 10. And what cause soever shall come to you of your brethren that dwell in the in their cities. It says between blood and blood, and between law and commandment, and statutes and judgments, ye shall even warn them. Ye shall even warn them that they trespass not against the Lord. And tell me, and so wrath come upon you and upon your brethren, this do, and ye shall not trespass. Those are the Levites. That's the ministry of the Levites. So that they minister to the people, they warn the people, they'll preach to the people, they will instruct the people, they will teach the people, they will counsel the people, so that wrath will not come upon them. When we ministers keep quiet and people do whatever they want, and they contradict the word of God, and they keep on sinning, and there's nobody to tell them about repentance, nobody to tell them about how they can have salvation, conversion, and how they can come to know the Lord in a real sense, a definite sense, and they keep on sinning, wrath will come upon them. But when you are able to stand like a Levite, like a leader in the church, a pastor in the church, and you preach the word faithfully without fear, without favor, then it says will prevent wrath from coming upon them. Let's look at chapter 29. In chapter 29 of 2 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 29, I'm reading here from verse 5. 2 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 5, and said unto them, hear me, ye Levites. You know, here we are again. The Levites will meet them once again. They play other place where we read. It was another period, another king talking to them. But here now, it's another king who is speaking to them. Hear me, ye Levites, sanctify yourselves and sanctify the house of the Lord God of your fathers, and carry forth the filthiness out of the holy place. You see what the Levites were to do? They look at the sanctuary of the Lord. They look at the holy place of the Lord, and if there's anything unclean there, they carry forth, they carry away, they take away all the uncleanness there as they ministered. And look at verse 8. In verse 8, it tells us in verse 8, it says, wherefore, tell me, the wrath of the Lord was upon Judah. And he goes on to say, and also upon Jerusalem. And he had delivered them to trouble. You know why? Because those Levites, there was a time they didn't fulfill their responsibility. And they were just Levites. They were Levites in name and in title. They carried the title. They didn't have the function. And they didn't have the performance of the work they were to do. Because of that, the wrath of God came upon the congregation. That's what the Lord is telling us, that those Levites, they were called for a purpose, and they were commissioned for a purpose, and they were consecrated for a purpose, and they were confirmed as sanctified, and it was so that they will minister to the people of God and prevent the wrath from coming upon them. I come to point number two now, is the purposeful ministry of true leaders. The purposeful ministry of true leaders. We're coming to Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 7. Matthew chapter 3, we're looking at verse 7. The Lord has called us, and he called us like he called John the Baptist. He called us like he called any of the leaders in the Bible. And here is what he did. Look at Matthew chapter 3 verse 7. It says, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who has warned you to flee from, tell me, the wrath to come. There's a wrath coming upon the people of the world, and there is wrath coming upon sinners in the world. And John the Baptist said, they must flee from the wrath to come. How do they do that? By repentance. We call people to repentance. And we tell them things that God has condemned in their lives. And we say, as long as this continues, there will be wrath upon your life. But as you turn, as you repent, as you reconcile with the Lord, then you flee from the wrath to come. In verse 8, bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. That's the calling he has given us, and I pray that every one of us will fulfill our call and calling in Jesus' name. We're looking at John chapter 3. John chapter 3, this is the chapter where Jesus spoke about the necessity of being born again. Ye must be born again. This is the chapter on the love of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. This is the chapter that tells us, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. But look at the last verse of that chapter, John chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 36. John chapter 3, verse 36, he that believeth on the Son has everlasting life, and he that believeth not on the Son, tell me, cannot see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. You know what? You are a minister, you are a preacher, you are a pastor, you are a leader. And people who are still in their sins, they come to the church, and you're busy entertaining them. You're busy encouraging them. You're busy talking about business and talking about prosperity and talking about, you know, if you follow the Lord. How do they follow the Lord? How do you understand by following the Lord? Tell them very clearly, if you repent and turn away from sin, and then you come out of sin and come to the Savior, come out of darkness and come to the light, and take Jesus Christ as your only Savior, your only Redeemer, and hold on to him as your personal Savior, and you follow him perpetually, then you escape the wrath to come. But if we're just patching the people, and we're not telling them the straight word of God that will get them out of sin, as if we're afraid of them, as if we don't know our calling, our commission, our consecration, and our confirmation, as if we do not understand, we are there, we are set there, so that as they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, they will flee and escape the wrath to come. We will rise up afresh. We'll declare the word of God in truth in Jesus' name. We're not going to follow the people that do not know the reason for ministry and are just in a church. They think church is business. They think a church is, you know, to make money. They think that church is just to gather the people together and just what they call an assembly. It is to tell those sinners that there is wrath to come and there is judgment. And the only way to be free from that judgment is to run away from darkness and sin, hold on to the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and be born again, and then live a life that is victorious, victorious over sin. Then the people will be free from the wrath in Jesus' name. We're looking at Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 4. Romans chapter 2, verse 4. The Lord does a lot of things in our lives as believers. Even sometimes when you are not a believer, the Lord can heal an unbeliever. The Lord can deliver an unbeliever. The Lord can provide for an unbeliever. But those some believers forget why those things are done to them. They forget why those blessings come to them. And we who are preachers too, sometimes we forget ourselves. A miracle has happened, somebody is healed, and something great has happened, and then we are carried away with that. We do not understand that that person that is healed, if he's still a sinner, the wrath of God is still hanging on his head. That person is delivered, if that person is not born again, the wrath of God is it very near, very close. That one that has a miracle child, miracle baby, after so many years, if he's not born again, if he has not fled from the wrath to come, the wrath of God is still there. But we're not telling them, we're just rejoicing with them that a miracle has taken place. We're looking at Romans chapter 2. I read here from verse 4. Romans chapter 2, verse what? Verse 4. It says, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long suffering? Look at this. Not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. That's the reason God has healed. That's the reason God has delivered the people. That's the reason all those miracles are done. It says these people, they despise the goodness of God. They make cheap the goodness of God, not knowing that the goodness of God came unto them to lead them to repentance. Look at verse 5. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up to thyself, tell me, wrath against the day of wrath. After healing, wrath against the day of wrath. After the miracle baby, wrath against the day of wrath. After the prosperity, wrath against the day of wrath. It says, the people that do not understand that the goodness of God is leading them to repentance, it says they treasure to themselves wrath against the day of wrath and the revelation of the righteous indignation of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. And then it says to them, who by patient continuance in well doing the seek for glory and also honor and immortality and eternal life. But unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, what follows? Indignation and wrath. When leaders forget their ministry, when leaders forget the reason why we're appointed to teach, appointed to preach, appointed to lead, appointed to counsel, appointed to answer questions, appointed to do whatever we're doing, when we forget that, and the people just come, they come to church for entertainment. They come to church for encouragement. They come to church so that their business will grow. They come to church so that they'll have some excitement and some, you know, kind of enjoyment. And then salvation is no more preached. Sanctification is no more emphasized. And we're not telling the people how they will escape the wrath to come. It says indignation will come upon them. Wrath will come upon them. Let's recover our ministry. And let us understand why he has called us and what he has called us to do. We're looking at Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 8. Romans chapter 5. We're looking at verse 8, and we'll see what the Lord is telling us here about how to be free from the wrath of God. And we need to tell the people, we need to instruct the people, we need to challenge the people that this is the reason why they are coming to the Lord, this is the reason why they are coming to the church, and this is the reason why you are appointed to preach unto them. In Romans chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 8, it says in verse 8, for God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Look at verse 9. Much more than being now justified by his grace, we shall be saved. We shall be saved from wrath through his life. That's the purpose. And then we tell the people, we instruct the people, we challenge the people, and we teach them to the point they understand that this is our calling. We teach them to the point they understand this is our commission. We tell them and teach them and testify to them until they understand, and until they actually take an action and they come out of their sin and they hold on to Calvary, to the cross, and then they are born again and they are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and then the wrath of God vanishes away from them. We're looking at Colossians chapter 3 now. Colossians chapter 3, here we're reading from verse 5. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. The word of God here emphasizes the fact, mortify therefore, that means to put to death, that means to kill, that means to destroy, that means to take away, that means to cast out of your life. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. And what are they? Tell me. Go on. Tell me again. And then, hold on now. You know, there are some people that feel that they are so dignified that never, they cannot pronounce the word fornication. Never. They say we're now civilized, as if Paul was not civilized. They say we're now well cultured, as if Jesus Christ, who used the word, was not well cultured. You see, we're not well refined, that we never mention a word like fornication. We never mention a word like adultery. We never mention a word like pornography. And when you just say, you know, we need to come to Christ, sinners don't understand. And then we need to repent of our sin. Sinners don't know what sins are. To them, sin is relative. You count this as wrong, it's wrong for you. You count drinking alcohol, you count that as wrong, that's wrong for you. You count, having a second woman wrong, that's wrong for you. But you know, for them, they say they don't find anything wrong because the woman gave her consent. In fact, that married woman ran after them and said, are you not a man? What are you going to? What are you looking at? Why don't you do this? They said, she was the one that even demanded. And she was the one that said, it makes me feel happy. They don't count it as sin. But it is when you read the word of God as a leader, as a pastor, as a preacher, and you nail it on the head and you say, here is what the word of God says, that fornication is a sin. And it's going to take people to hell. And then you say, polygamy is a sin. Adultery is going to take people to hell. Then the wake up, and the dead consciences are waking, because here is your ministry now. You are to save them from the wrath to come. That's why if you look at the New Testament, I want you to check up. You look at Matthew, you'll find the word fornication, you'll find adultery, and Jesus used the word. If you come to Mark, you're going to find those words, fornication, adultery, and Jesus used the word. If you come to Luke, you're going to find that word, fornication, adultery. If you come to John, that word is there. If you come to Acts of the Apostles, the word is there. If you come to Romans, those words are there. First Corinthians chapter 6, those words are there. And you come to Second Corinthians, then you come to all the other, you come to Ephesians, the words are there. And then you come to Colossians here, and he mentions the word and he nails it on the head. How is it that we're so much refined, and we cannot follow the Bible and says this is what God calls sin, and if the people are going to know what to flee from and what to escape from, they have to flee from this. That's why it says over here, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. And it says fornication, it says uncleanness, it says inordinate affection, and then it says evil concupiscence and covetousness. Tell me what follows. which is idolatry. Covetousness is idolatry. That means you want something so much, and you want that above the commandment of God. You want that above the warning of God. You want that above God himself, and it becomes an idolatry for you. And it says in verse 6, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience. And that's why we're raised up as ministers. That's why we're raised up as leaders, that everything will be very clear, everything will be sharp, everything will be focused, and then the people know why we're there, and they know what they are repenting from. And as they repent, the Lord will forgive them and cleanse their lives and change their lives, and they will not be the same anymore in Jesus' name. We're coming to Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, the reason why the Lord has called us is to warn the people so that they will flee from the wrath of God. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, and I'm reading here from verse 10. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 10, it says, wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swear, how? Tell me out loud. I swear in my wrath that they shall not enter my rest. You see that? And this is the New Testament. And the New Testament is warning us that the people of the old generation, they were not able to enter into the land of Canaan, into the promised rest, because they offended the Lord. After they were saved out of Egypt, they went back again in their mind, in their hearts, and he said, let us choose us a captain that we may return to Egypt. Although they didn't return in the physical, their minds returned, and God swore that it is wrath that they will not enter into the land of Canaan. Look at verse 12. Take heed therefore. It says, take heed therefore. Who are the people he's talking to? Brethren, believers, those who have come out. Take it therefore, brethren. It says, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily. You see that? Exhort one another daily, so we don't become used to sin, so we don't become acclimatized to evil, so we don't take it easy and say, well, it doesn't matter anymore. It says, speak to one another every day and exhort one another daily, as it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. I pray that we'll be steadfast in Jesus' name. We're looking at chapter 4, Hebrews chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 1. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering in into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. For but it says, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. It says, they go on then to say, for we which have believed do enter into unto rest, as he said, that I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest. He swore in his wrath that they will not enter into his rest. Look at verse 6. Seeing therefore, it remains that it remains that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Verse 11, let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fail after the same manner of unbelief. Verse 16, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find help in the time of need. It's telling us that the grace of God is still available, but we need to tell the people, they turn away from sin, they come to the Lord, they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and a mighty change, a wonderful change, a character change comes upon them, and then they enter into his rest. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. It says, for they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we urge unto you, how ye turned, that's the word, how ye turned, how they repented, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead. Then he goes on to say, even Jesus, which delivered us, tell me, from the wrath to come. And so you see the ministry of the leaders today, of the pastors today, of the preachers today, he wants to use us to help people to come out of the wrath that is hanging on their heads. And that's why we do whatever we do in the ministry. That's why we preach. That's why we witness. That's why we visit. That's why we intercede. That's why we distribute tracts. That's why we call people to the fellowship. And that's the reason why we pray for people. That's the reason why we correct people. That's the reason why we teach and minister. And we do whatever we do so that the people will understand that if we don't repent, there's wrath, the wrath to come. I pray God will make us faithful in the calling he has given every one of us in Jesus' name. I come to point number three, the perpetual misery of the lost. The perpetual misery of the lost. If we are going to fulfill the ministry, we'll tell them of the mystery, of the misery which is to come. And we'll show them how they're going to be free from that misery. In John chapter 3, we read that before, we need to read that again. John chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 36. In verse 36 it says, he that believeth on the Son has everlasting life. And he that believeth not on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Abideth, that's in the present tense, continuous. That means if that person dies in sin and he has not been saved, he's not come to the Savior to be born again, and he dies in that condition, perpetually the wrath of God, the judgment of God, the indignation of God, and the fiery punishment of God, eternal, abides on him. If the person backslides, and we do not want them that as they are backsliding, they need to come to know the Lord and to be restored into the grace of God again. If they die in that backsliding condition, a man or a woman, whatever his position, whatever her position before, if he dies in that condition, it will be perpetual hellfire, because it's the wrath to come, and the wrath of God abideth continually on him. I pray that the Lord will help us to warn the people, and we ourselves too are the ones, so that we don't enter into the wrath of God in Jesus' name. In Ephesians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 5. Ephesians chapter 5, please back up to verse 3. Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 3, it says, but fornication, here's the word again. I think, there are people, because probably they are kind of guilty in their lives. Probably because they themselves, they are the slaves and they are the captives of immorality. Because of that, that what shocks them. And because of, they never want to mention a word like that, it makes them themselves feel guilty. and feel condemned, and that therefore they avoid all that. But you know, if we're going to be faithful to the calling God has given us, many people are in that kind of terrible sin, and many people are into that defilement in their lives. And so if we're going to be faithful to the Lord and faithful to the people, and we want them to be free from the wrath to come, we're not going to shy away from what the word of God has said. That's what why it says, but fornication and all uncleanness and covetousness, let it not be once named among you, as becometh who? As becometh saints, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather the giving of thanks. For this ye know. Look at this now. For this ye know. The minister to know this, the preacher to know this, the pastor to know this, the teacher ought to know this, the leader ought to know this. It says, for this ye know, that no whoremonger, no unclean person, no covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of God and of Christ. Let no man deceive you. Let no cultured man deceive you. Let no refined man deceive you. And let no advisor, counselor deceive you. Let no man deceive you with vain words. For because of these things cometh, tell me, the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. And that's why the Lord is emphasizing to us that we shall remember our calling, remember our commission, remember our consecration, remember our confirmation, that we're called to preach the word of God and to help the people who are sinners come out of their sins and to come to know the Lord as their personal Savior. First Thessalonians, I'm reading from chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 16. First Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 16, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved. Forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved. Have you had the experience sometimes that you bring a daughter of one of the members of the church, and this daughter has not been living right? The daughter is wayward, and you feel concerned, and the father and the mother, they even happen to be members of the church. And then you call this daughter, and you are talking to the daughter, and the daughter is getting under conviction, and maybe she's about crying, and the mother seems, the mother at that time is, passing on, and then saw the daughter, and saw that the daughter is getting disturbed from what you're sharing, and then will come there and say, what's that, what's that, oh, what's happening to my daughter, come. She doesn't want the daughter to come under conviction, and she doesn't want that man, that preacher, that counselor to get into details that the daughter will confess to that preacher, and then they will know that our children are not holy, they are not righteous, because we have been covering them, we have been covering them up, and somebody is coming now and preaching the word of God to them, and that kind of disturbs us because of the pride of the parent. And here, look at verse 16 again, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved. You know, sometimes it's like, the preacher is talking on something, and the thing is, is knocking on the life of the wife of a man inside that place. And, the husband is wondering, this man is going too far, he's mentioning that. And, he loves his wife to the point, he doesn't ever want the wife to be disturbed, or to have conviction, or to go on her knees and repent. She is sympathizing with the wife. My wife must be feeling miserable now because of what this preacher is saying. And if he had his way, he would either shut up that preacher or take the wife and go out. Look at the verse again. It says, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved. You know, sometimes you invite somebody to the church, and this person, according to you, is, highly placed and a dignified person, and then you invited the person to the church to come and enjoy the service. enjoy the service. We're not supposed to make people enjoy the service. We're to make them see the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and see themselves as miserable sinners, as people that if they do not believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, they will die, they will perish and go to hell. That's our calling. But I brought him to enjoy the service. And look at what the pastor is talking about today. He's talking about occultism. He's talking about secret cult. He's talking about sexuality. And he's talking about those people who are joined to the devil. And if you die in that secret cult, you know, you will go to hell. Look at the preacher mentioning hell. When these dignified preachers, when they're around, and then immediately after we finish the service, you know, the man goes to take the person he brought to the church, and he's, you know, he wants to, you know, now undo everything the preacher has said. I hope you are not disturbed. I hope what the preacher said did not, you know, bother you. I hope you'll come the next time. You know, it's not always like that. Well, I don't know what happened today that the preacher was just hammering on this and hammering on. And if he said anything that bothered you, just, you know, don't mind, you know. And also, he's a new preacher. He's, you know, we're just managing him. He will grow, and when he grows, he'll grow out of that thing and not talk about that again. What are you doing? You forbid us to preach to them so that they might be saved. Look at the rest of the verse. In that verse, Christine says, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved, to fill up their sins always, for the wrath is come upon them to the uttermost. The people that forbid preachers preaching the word, that people might be saved, so that sinners are not disturbed, so that sinners are not convicted, so that sinners are not converted, the wrath of God also abides on them. The word of God is very clear. There's the wrath of God upon sinners. And the reason why those Levites were raised up is so that they will prevent the congregation from having the wrath of God upon them. And the reason why you and I are raised up is so that we also preach the word and declare the word of God, so that every sinner in the congregation will personally repent and turn to the Lord. And then the believers will understand that this is the calling we have, this is the commission we have, this is the consecration we have, and this is the confirmation we're supposed to have, that we go out to declare the word of God, and sinners will repent. And sinners will come to know the Lord. The danger of deeper life is looking at all the other churches and looking at what those other churches say, what those other churches do, how those other churches preach, what those other churches do not mention, what those churches emphasize, and then we say, look at them, they're growing, look at them, they're rich, look at them, they have this, look at them, we have that. And then we want to modify and we want to tailor what we're preaching to what those people are saying. They are lost, and if we are like them and they are lost, we too shall be lost. I pray that you will earnestly contend for the faith was delivered unto the saints. Amen. Moses preached without fear, without favor. Caleb told the people without fear, without favor. And Nathan came to David and he confronted him without fear and without favor. Amos preached to the people that man said, go out of this place and go and preach in your village. This is the place of the college of the king. And he said, I was no priest before, I was no prophet, but God chose me out of gathering the fruit, and he called me to declare the word. Two cannot walk together except they be agreed. And he gave them the word. John the Baptist preached the word. He even told Herod directly, it's wrong for you to take your brother's wife. He suffered for it, but thank God he's now in heaven. There was somebody that was able to confront Ahab. His name is Elijah. You see, all these people in the Bible, they did their part so that they will warn the people from the wrath to come. And God has raised you up, has raised me up today. We're going to do our duty. we will preach the word. And you know, there are people that they worry too much about wisdom, 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 and they're praying for the pastor God to give him wisdom. They're praying for the group pastor God to give him wisdom. They're praying for all the preachers God to give them wisdom. Stop that kind of prayer, because I know that the way you are praying, you want God to give John the Baptist wisdom so that he will not talk to Herod that it's wrong for you to marry your brother's wife. That's the kind of wisdom they're talking about. And then Paul the apostle, Felix came before him and he spoke about judgment to come, and Felix trembled. They're praying for Paul the apostle so that he'll have wisdom, and then he'll minimize the word, and then they'll speak of even John the beloved. He said, if anybody comes to you and does not have this doctrine, he says, don't accept into your house. If you bid him even Godspeed, you are partaker of their evil. All those people, they preach the word of God, and Jesus Christ, of course, he preached the word of God. He said, all those that the tower Babel of Shiloh fell on, they perish. But except she repent, he shall likewise tell me, perish. And in Jesus' day, Paul did it, all the other people did it, were rising up like an army. And we're going to preach the word of God, because we're not to pet the people, entertain the people, we're not to make the people enjoy anything, we're to warn them flee from the wrath to come. And assure yourself you have escaped from the wrath to come, and then you're standing at the gate over there, you are hindering people from getting further into the pit of hell, and you're saying, I'm here to warn the people. I pray God will honor your ministry, and God will help you, and many people will come out of the wrath of God in Jesus' name. The others before us did it. It's come to my turn, I will do it. I said, I will do it. Brothers and sisters, we'll do it in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord and tell the Lord, Lord, this is the ministry you have called us to, and we will do it. You need to strength. You need to have courage. You do it with power. You do it with anointing. You do it with conviction. And you do it without fear. You do it without favor. And then you declare the word of God to the people. And those who are living in sin, they will fear. And they will come out of sin. And then they'll be saved. And after they are saved, you keep on teaching them so that they remain out of the wrath of God. And they remain in the love of God.